Coming up in part three of our trip around Tasmania, we leave Forth and move on to Sulphur Creek and camp here for 3 nights at a campsite called Midway. Using our campground at Midway as a base, we venture into Burnie and have a look at the wonderful park there. We go out and we have a look at the Wings Wildlife Park. And while at the Wings Wildlife Park, we just ponder over what it would be like to camp alongside this lake that they offer camping at. After leaving the parking area there at Sulphur Creek, we move on to the very beautiful Stanley, one of our favourite locations so far in our trip. We go up to the top of the nut at Stanley and capture some magnificent views, and as well as that, we have the wonderful pleasure of watching the little penguins come home after a day's fishing. All that and more in part three. I'm Mick, and this is Sally. Together we've been caravanning Australia since the 1980s, and more recently we started to put the videos together just to show you some of what we see out there. There's a lot to see in Australia, and we hope you enjoy what we have here to show you. You can follow us on our trips via the following social media platforms. If you like the following video, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. As we leave our campground at Forth, we take advantage of a water tap and fill up all our water tanks on the caravan. The bottom tank fill system that we have on this caravan certainly makes this process much, much easier. To go from one location to another in Tasmania, we're quickly learning that it doesn't take very long as they're all short distances, and the one that we travelled from one campground to another here is no different. With only 29 kilometres to travel, we were soon there.
Now, good morning everyone, and we've successfully moved, so we're now over to Midway, and that's a campground here at Sulphur Creek. So welcome to the start of another video of Tasmania. A little bit overcast today, but I think that's going to clear off, hopefully, the way the sun's been coming out since we've got here. But here for the 3 nights, and we'll see what we can find in this area. Hope you enjoy.
It was a gloomy sort of a day once we arrived here, and the crowd was quite large. You had to get in early on these sort of campgrounds, otherwise you did struggle to get a good spot, but we were lucky enough, we got one out on the front and we had an ocean view. The campground here is between two main thoroughfares, I guess, one being a road and one being a railway line, but even though you were there, once it come night time, the area did quieten down quite a bit. The railway line here was between the campground and the ocean, and not very far from the campground at all, as you can see here, but when trains did go through, they weren't very noisy. They were going at a reasonably slow pace, and we only heard one go through during the middle of one night, and that, once again, wasn't very loud at all. It was our second day here at Sulphur Creek Campground that the sun started to shine, and as you can see by the images here, it certainly is a picture to be in this sort of camping location on the ideal day. It was around the middle of the day when I had the drone up in the sky on this particular day, and come late afternoon, early evening, the campground was full. With no rain being forecasted today, we thought we'd go in and have a look at Burnie Park in at Burnie, but on our way to Burnie, we stopped here at the Blythe River. The Blythe River is very much affected by the ocean tides here, so if you were to launch your boat at the boat ramp and try and get out into open waters, you would have to know what you were doing, particularly if you tried to get through here when the water was low. Very pretty location this one, with the river water meeting the ocean currents. Very picturesque. Now in the town of Burnie, we ventured on to Burnie Park and we went in there for a bit of a look around. It's always a relaxing thing to be able to walk around in a park like this. The ground was immaculate, the lawns were mowed and not very much leaf matter on the ground at all, but nah, certainly nice blue skies and green lawns, beautiful. The water feature area in the middle of the park, with the picnic area and the barbecues and the kids' playground, was certainly a picture to look at. The flowering plants here at the water feature, I think had sort of gone past their best use by date, but I think had we been here a few months earlier when everything was flowering to its full potential, it would certainly throw the wow factor at us. These water birds here, they certainly seem to know where they thought the best spot was going to be. With the water trickling over the wall here and very little wind, just a slight breeze, it certainly gave you that feeling of relaxation. Burnie Park, certainly a place you could spend a full day at if we had the time, but unfortunately we didn't, but that's just the way that the things roll. And oh, look at this, so beautiful, green, clean, and I was starting to fall behind while I was filming all this, and Sally was up waiting for me, so I had to get a move on and try and catch up with her and before she started to wonder where I was. Now leaving all the green area behind us, we started to make the short walk up to Old Dacca Falls. The path leading up to the falls was a flat, even, easy to walk on firm ground, and you could take a wheelchair up there, although there are stairs right at the end and that would prevent you from going right to the falls, but you could still certainly see the falls from this path that we're walking on. It was a very pretty walk up to the falls with these big ferns here on the right hand side to look at as you were walking along the path. Now having reached the base of the stairs that take you up to the waterfall themselves, you can see that from the section of the bottom of the stairs, you can actually see the waterfalls from this point. It doesn't appear as though there's a lot of water coming over the falls, but we don't know, we haven't been here before. Perhaps this is normal, so if there's normally more water coming over, leave a note in the comment below and let us know. For most of our time at the Sulphur Creek Campground here at Midway, we had overcast weather, but that didn't really worry us. A little bit cool to what we're normally used to, but never mind. And from there, we started to work out the timetable as the trains went down the line. The train drivers, if they saw that someone in the campground was actually out watching them as they were going past, they were always willing to give that friendly toot. It was middle of the morning when we left our campground and we did the 31Ks that was going to take us out to the Wings Wildlife Park. For us, the road came across as undulating and windy, but that's just something that we're not used to, of course, coming from the mainland in Australia, but quite a normal thing over here in Tasmania to expect these sort of roads. In saying that, we did have some beautiful landscape views, as seen from the road as we were driving along. Once we'd completed the 31 kilometre drive out to the Wings Wildlife Park, we were soon ready to see what the park had to offer us. Once we'd parked our car, we made our way to the entry to the wildlife park, paid our entry fee, and then started to go inside the park for a look around. After being blown away by the size of these trout in the holding tank, we wandered over to have a look at this baby wombat, as I don't know whether he could see us or whether he was just bored, but he kept doing this on and off all the time that we were there. Always nice to see echidnas in the wild, and even in captivity, they're certainly a beautiful animal. Once outside in the open area of the park, we made our way up to the Tassie Devils, and these fellas, it'd certainly be nice to see one of these out in the wild. I'm not quite sure whether we will on our trip whilst we're here, but certainly would be good if we do. In captivity, they seem to be noisy and possibly aggressive, and I wonder what they would be like in the wild, whether they would see you and run for fear of their own life, or whether they'd stand their own ground. Oh, you gotta love a cuddly wombat. I wouldn't want to hit one out in the wild. They're certainly big and solid and a real menace to the car if you did hit one, but in captivity, oh, they're such a cuddly sort of creature, you want to pick one up and just cuddle it. As well as a fair selection of winged parrots and birds and so on in this wildlife park, there was also a mix of animals. As we're getting near the McCall birdcage here, I'm sure this fella actually called us over or spoke to us, and he was very interested when we were there talking to him, but we couldn't get him to speak whilst we were so close. As we moved around the wildlife park, there were different presentations on different animals going at different times of the day, of course, and as we went past the koala here, it was time for the koala presentation. It's always interesting to hear how these sort of people look after the animals that they're in charge of. All of the walking tracks here is accessible and easily accessible by people of all ages, from young to old, as well as that it does offer easy access for wheelchairs. These young fellas, no matter what they're doing, they're always an entertainment to the crowd. Yellow-tailed black cockatoo, a very big bird in reality, and certainly a friendly one, this one. He just wanted to come up and get as close to you as what he could. From the area where all the birds were, we started to make our way down to the section that the kangaroos were held in. And here you can walk around amongst them and feed them if you wish, but if you want to feed them, you need to buy the pellets from the entry area when you first come into the park, where you pay your entry form, or entry fee I should say, and bring those pellets with you. We didn't purchase any pellets for hand feeding of the kangaroos when we came in, and we started to feel a bit guilty after a while, because no sooner you went up into the yard, the kangaroos started to approach you looking for something to eat. Even though some did approach us looking for something to eat, I don't think they were very hungry, because a lot of them were too lazy and too relaxed and enjoying the day to even worry about coming up and asking for anything. The best I could do for them today was just a friendly chat and a bit of a scratch under the chin. From the kangaroo enclosure, we started to make our way out to the farm walk, and it's here where the larger animals are held in open paddocks. No sooner had we started our farm walk, and this big ostrich made his way up to the fence, and I'm not quite sure what his intentions were, whether he thought I was a threat and he wanted to get rid of me, or what the go was, or whether he thought I might be his next partner in the farm stay, but he was quite bizarre in what he was doing. And if anyone knows what he's doing here and what he's trying to imply, please leave us a comment because I'd be very interested to find out. No farmyard display would be quite complete without one of the Australian emus being in it. The tracks that take you around the farm display is for motor vehicles, and I guess they use that for feeding of the animals and the likes, but very easy to walk on, and there was no tripping hazards or anything like that. So once again, open for all ages and wheelchair accessible. As you make your way around the farm walk, the views of the hills are certainly stunning. There is a small dam in the middle of the farm walk, and the amount of water birds that was on the dam, there was just too many to count. Bison are always a nice animal to see in an open range setting similar to what we've got here, and with such a beautiful backdrop, you could watch them all day. The white donkey here, he didn't mind a scratch on the side of the head at all. The Highland cow, I don't know what it is, there's something attractive about these, but certainly a pretty animal to look at. You can bring your caravan or motorhome out to the wildlife park and set up camp here, and wouldn't it be nice camping alongside this water with such a view? It was our last night here at the Midway Campground, and what a beautiful sunset to finish off with. Time to move on to another campground, and this time we're heading up to Stanley, and this would have to be one of our longest travelling days so far since we've been here at Tasmania. With only 91 kilometres of travel, we were soon there.
Now, well, we've made it to Stanley. We left the Midway Campground there at Sulphur Creek this morning, and a bit of a blowy old day coming down here today, even blowy now. 1 minute it's raining, then we've got a bit of sunshine, and then the rain comes back out again, and you're just not quite sure what you're going to finish up with. So not a lot happening this afternoon. We've been up, we had a bit of a look at the nut and where the chairlift is, and we'll go up there tomorrow. It's supposed to be a beautiful day tomorrow, and go up the top of there and see what we can see, so it should be good, but we may only be here for 2 nights yet, we're not real sure, so we'll see how we go on that one.
As soon as we arrived here at the Stanley Recreational Ground, which is right alongside the showgrounds, we emptied the toilet, and they offer water points here that you can fill up the caravan. You can't stay connected to it, but we filled up our tanks and soon set ourselves up on a site. We have found that by arriving at these campgrounds early to middle part of the morning, you've got a better choice of what part of the campground you want to set yourself up in. With the weather forecast being correct for today being the day, as far as the sun was going to shine and the wind wasn't going to be very strong, we made our way up to the top of the nut. We took a chairlift going up, and a very steep climb up, so we thought that was going to be the easiest option. The gentleman here operating the chairlift on the top side informed us as we got off that if we were going to do the complete circuit walk, the best option, as far as he knew, and he didn't know why people were recommending it, but they were, to go in a clockwise direction, so that's exactly what we did do. The start of our walk on this direction started off on a very flat terrain type country, as seen here. As you make your way around the nut, the views that were on offer were absolutely spectacular. Beautiful scenery, and it was a nice day, the water was calm, and with the sun out, Oh, you couldn't have got a better day. The walking trail that we were following had this mesh grate type thing on it, and it's certainly made for sure footing. As we made our way around the top of the nut, if you were to put a rating out of 10 on the views, you'd have to say it was at least a 12. And no doubt if we had have come up here on an overcast gloomy sort of day, you'd probably rate it as a 5. Each of the main lookouts had its own name, and the views that were on offer from these lookouts was really something spectacular. Continuing our walk around the nut, the terrain now started to change to more bushy, scrubby type area and left the flat grounds behind us. With the path now taking us in amongst and through the bushes, we were quite surprised to see this little fella here, and apparently they're called paddy melons, which was a bit of a surprise because back in the mainland on Australia, a paddy melon is a bit of a foreign weed type thing that has a fruit on it, something like a watermelon. We were so lucky on our trip up to the top of the nut with such a clear day, it gave us these great views over a vast distance. Continuing on, we made our way to the next lookout, which was a Highfield lookout. And once again, it gave us great views over the town of Stanley and also back towards the Fisherman's Wharf. If you do a trip to Stanley and are unable to go up to the top of the nut, you can take a drive, and that will give you this view looking back at the nut and the town of Stanley from an elevated position while still in the motor car. While out on this drive on our return, we called into the Highfield Historical Site to have a look at the building there. While there, we did a self-guided tour around the homestead, and as well as that, also included the associated buildings. There is a lot of history associated with this site and the building, and I'll leave a link that will take you to the internet page, and if you wish to pursue that history, it'll be there for you to read. I thought there was something different with the chapel and the schoolroom here all being in the one building. On the bottom floor was the chapel itself. And then when you go upstairs, that was a schoolroom and where all the learning and the teaching was done. It would be interesting to know why it was done on the two levels like this and not completed in two separate buildings. As we made our way back to the caravan, we thought we'd stop off at the main beach here at Stanley and have a look to where the penguins were coming in each night, and they've got that viewing platform there, and we wanted to have a look so perhaps we could come back later on that night and watch the little fellas come up after their day out hunting in the ocean to return back to their nests. It was a long viewing platform, this one, so certainly it catered for large numbers, so this must be where it all happens at the appropriate time. So later on that night, we were going to come back and have a look. Do you ever get that feeling that when you see something, you think, yeah, that'll do me, or yeah, that suits me? Well, that's the sort of feeling that both Sally and I had when we drove into Stanley. There was just something about the atmosphere and the buildings of the town that sort of made us think that, yep, this is a lovely place. As we're walking around today, there doesn't seem to be a lot of people in the view of the camera, but don't be fooled by that, because we thought we might get a quick bite to eat for lunch as we were walking and keep those walking legs going. But everywhere that we went into any shop or eatery of any kind, they were booked out and there was a waiting period before you could get a table so you could be served. So quite incredible. It looks quiet here in the street, but believe me, each shop was doing a roaring trade. Stanley is predominantly a fishing town, but no doubt tourism would play a big part in their survival. The calm and very pretty blue water down here at the Fisherman's Wharf shows what sort of day we're enjoying. And isn't it just a magic view? Such blue in the water and a clear sky and no wind, it's just magical. Continue on with the nice day that we've been having. It's early evening, so we're back down at the beach and we're here to have a look at the penguins come home after their day out fishing. And it was a beautiful day and hopefully followed up by a successful night down here. If you look closely at some of the nesting wood boxes here under the main viewing platform, you can see penguins sitting in there, and they must be, we assume, young ones waiting for mum and dad to come home. Before the penguins started to come home from their day out fishing, this young one here, on two occasions, came down to the edge of the area here, down to where the rocks start on the beach, to check to see, well, we assume, to check to see if they were coming home. Perhaps the poor little fellow was hungry, we don't know, but he was starting to get impatient. The suggested time that the little penguins would come in from the water to go to their nesting burrows at this time of the year was approximately 8:30 p.m. and we were starting to think that perhaps they wouldn't be in. We didn't really know, because no one was, no penguins were turning up, but eventually they started coming in just before 9 p.m. The first group of these wonderful little penguins assembled here in this area, and they seemed to stay there for some time before they wanted to move on. We're not quite sure whether it was the crowd, because there was a big crowd here viewing this, whether the crowd was putting them off or whether that was something that they normally did. Then, as a group, they all started to move up towards their burrows, which was underneath the viewing platform that everyone was standing on. To see the little penguins come home like they have, it was a great experience and a privilege to watch.
Oh, g'day everyone, and it comes to the end of another video. Oh, beautiful place it is, this Tasmania. We could spend many years over here, I think, and still not see it all, but we've really enjoyed what we're seeing so far, and we hope that you've enjoyed seeing what we've shown you. We move on tomorrow morning and we go down to a place called Tall Timbers. It's Smithton, I think it is. So hopefully we'll get in when we get down there, and we'll start the next video from there. So until that video goes up, you take care and look after yourself. If you like the video that you just watched, give us a thumbs up. And if you want to see more of our videos, click on the subscribe button. And once you've done that, change the bell notification to all. That way, every time that we do uploads to our YouTube channel, you'll be notified.